Hello students, I'm glad that you are watching this video about Tclk, the blockchain-powered information platform. At the beginning of 2020, the disease COVID-19 spread rapidly through China, causing the government to shut down many businesses and impose strict social distancing rules. To contain the virus, anyone who might have come into contact with an infected individual had to be tested and quarantined if necessary. Wuhua Ma and his team created an application called Tong Cheng Lian Kang, or TCLK for short, which listed crowdsourced information on publicly known cases of COVID-19 so that users could search whether they had been in a closed-off space with an infected individual. The application leveraged blockchain technology to record and validate user submissions of COVID-19 cases to ensure that submission and validation data was immutable, transparent, and decentralized. Users could volunteer to submit publicly recorded cases of COVID-19 or help validate the submissions of others in exchange for digital tokens on the blockchain platform, which could be used to redeem small gifts. As the number of new COVID-19 cases decreased, Ma needed to identify other business situations where he could apply this TCLK model. This case explains the basics of blockchain technology and digital tokens and explores their key benefits in the context of a pandemic. After completion of the case, you should be able to understand the challenges of efficiently disseminating information during a pandemic. Also, assess the key features and benefits of blockchain. Third, evaluate the ability of blockchain's features to increase the efficiency of information sharing. And finally, considerations of implementing disruptive technology in a crisis environment. COVID-19 is a coronavirus disease that attacks the respiratory system, causing most patients to develop dry cough, fever, and in extreme cases, pneumonia and death. The first case of COVID-19 was discovered in December 2019, but how the disease transmitted to humans was still unconfirmed as of April 2020. COVID-19 is more dangerous than the seasonal flu because of the following. High death rate. The death rate of COVID-19 is estimated to be 10 times that of seasonal flu. People who are older or have underlying health conditions are at the greatest risk, but young and healthy individuals have also succumbed to the disease. High transmission rate. The transmission rate of a disease is measured by its R-naught, which indicates the average number of people each sick individual will infect. The seasonal flu has an R-naught of 1.3, while COVID-19 is estimated to be twice as contagious, with an R-naught of between 2 and 3. Another reason COVID-19 is more dangerous than the flu is that there is no effective treatment or vaccine. Because no effective treatment or vaccines existed as of April 2020, the majority of the population was still susceptible to infection with no way to create herd immunity unless a critical mass within the population had been infected by the virus. And finally, a long incubation period. The incubation period of a disease indicates the average time between an individual's exposure to a disease and the appearance of first symptoms. COVID-19 had an estimated incubation period of 5 days compared with the common flu, which has an incubation period of 2 days. All of these attributes of COVID-19 have increased the importance of slowing its spread to ensure that healthcare systems do not become overwhelmed by the volume of patients in critical conditions. The primary barriers for governments are supply shortages, creating effective policies that promote social distancing, and identifying individuals who may have been exposed to the virus. So what factors make containment of the disease so difficult? One is supply shortages. Many governments, including China, faced supply shortages amid the pandemic, resulting in healthcare workers and other citizens unable to access sufficient personal protective equipment, or PPE, to shield themselves from the virus. This supply shortage was caused by both a surge in demand for these products due to the virus and waning supply, given the disruption COVID-19 has caused across global supply chains. Another factor preventing the containment of COVID-19 is the lack of effective policies for social distancing. Governments also faced difficulty implementing policies that promoted social distancing to reduce the spread of the virus. In China, because many older citizens relied on their families for support, mandating social distancing required considerations on how these at-risk individuals would receive the care they needed. To protect elderly citizens, China leveraged its existing neighborhood party branches for support, particularly the urban neighborhood resident committees and rural village resident committees. These committees were put in charge of monitoring the local population and identifying empty nesters and elders who were living alone and people who were disabled or frail so that the government could reach out and provide the necessary support. However, not all essential services had the infrastructure to provide contactless delivery, so governments had only limited success in promoting social distancing across society. Another factor preventing containment is the challenge of identifying exposed individuals. The issue that is most relevant for Tclk is the difficulty in determining which citizens have been exposed to the virus. Because of COVID-19's lengthy incubation period, many citizens were unaware that they had been in contact with any sick individuals because their symptoms had not yet emerged. Therefore, a key barrier to virus containment was the ability to identify and quarantine these carriers of the disease during its incubation period. Individuals and organizations began launching applications to help consolidate information on publicly known cases of the virus to inform citizens about their potential exposure to a sick individual who might not have shown symptoms at the time of exposure. So what are existing solutions for aggregating information on COVID-19 cases? And what are their weaknesses? The existing solutions are primarily third-party applications that allow users to search publicly verified cases of COVID-19 patients at high-risk locations such as planes, subways, trains, and public events. These applications allow Chinese citizens to confirm whether they have been exposed to the virus and to seek the necessary testing or treatment if they find that they have come within close proximity to a COVID-19 patient. These applications also allow users to submit cases that do not appear on the application or to flag errors they find in displaying information. But the process has little transparency in terms of data validation and correction. The existing solutions are lacking in terms of transparency, reliability, and scalability. Regarding transparency, no information is shared about who is submitting or validating cases, how information is being fact-checked, and which submissions are being omitted. Regarding reliability, the administrator is a single point of failure. Therefore, any mistake the administrator makes can compromise data integrity. And lack of scalability. Because the administrator is in charge of posting all submissions and correcting all errors, the application will require an increasing number of administrators as submissions increase. So what is blockchain and what are its benefits? Blockchain is a distributed ledger. Distributed means data is stored on a network of nodes. All participating parties maintain and construct the ledger. The ledger means that transactions are recorded in a verifiable and permanent way, creating a complete record of transactions over the ledger's lifetime. Blockchains can be public, private, or consortium. Public blockchains are permissionless, meaning that any individual can access information on the blockchain, submit transactions, and participate in the consensus procedure. Users in the network can obtain economic incentives for their contributions toward the transaction verification process. The network is entirely decentralized, and participants in the network are able to remain anonymous because of the lack of a central authority. Because of the decentralized nature of public blockchains, these networks require more time and computing power to reach consensus, leading to slower performance compared with other forms of blockchain. Examples of public blockchains include Bitcoin and Ethereum. Private blockchains are permissioned, which means that a single organization controls access to read and write information on the blockchain. Because private blockchains have a limited number of participants and the verification process is centralized, the speed of processing transactions is much faster than public blockchains, but at the expense of transparency and security. Private blockchains are often used in enterprise settings, where the benefits of a distributed ledger can be leveraged without sacrificing processing speed. Consortium blockchains are a hybrid of public and private blockchains, where the consensus procedure is controlled by a small group of nodes within the network, rather than by a single organization, in other words, a private blockchain, or by all nodes within the network, in other words, public. Permissions to read and write are flexible and can be determined by the consensus of the controlling nodes. Consortium blockchains are common in cross-enterprise settings, where a group of organizations within the same industry or supply chain needs to share information in a secure, efficient, and transparent manner. In the context of this case, blockchain provides an effective way to track and consolidate information. Because blockchains are immutable and transparent, no central authority is required to approve every change to the blockchain. As a result, information can be shared by all users while maintaining a high level of reliability due to the validation process by other nodes within the network. Blockchain also improves the scalability of such models because content creation and validation responsibilities are distributed across the network rather than a single node. Therefore, the concerns around existing solutions, as highlighted in our discussion of transparency, reliability, and scalability, can all be addressed through the integration of blockchain. So how does the Tclk application function? At the application layer, which is the layer that users see, Tclk functions similarly to many of its competing applications. Users are able to search for cases of COVID-19 and submit new cases that do not appear on the application. Tclk also added functionality for users to help validate submissions, which addresses many of the problems of existing solutions discussed above. The application uses blockchain to crowdsource information on publicly known cases of COVID-19. These cases, along with details such as time, location, and patient description, are available on local government websites but are not consolidated, making it difficult for citizens to query. Users can submit cases from these government websites onto this Tclk blockchain, and other users can help validate the information to ensure a high level of reliability. All submission data are stored on two separate blockchains, Jingtum and Moac. Jingtum is a consortium blockchain based in China, while Moac is a public blockchain based in the United States. Storing data on both blockchains improves the level of data security and diversifies the risk of a single blockchain failing. Using both a public blockchain and a consortium blockchain also allows Tclk to enjoy the benefits of both types of blockchains, with increased speed and efficiency coming from Jingtum and greater transparency from Moac. To encourage users to volunteer by submitting new COVID-19 cases or validating existing submissions, Tclk offers Jingtum tokens, which can be used to redeem small gifts on the Jingtum platform. These tokens not only provide additional incentive for users to volunteer, but also redirect volunteers between submission and validation duties by changing the number of tokens provided for each of the tasks. Tclk decides on the amount of compensation based on where volunteers are most needed so that the ratio of submitters and validators remains balanced. So how does Tclk differ from existing solutions? Compared with other applications that perform a similar function, Tclk differs on three fronts: data storage, the validation process, and the incentive structure. Regarding data storage, alternative applications store their data in traditional databases instead of a blockchain. Traditional databases are inferior to blockchain in two areas. First, less security. Because data are stored on specific servers, these applications have a single point of failure. In contrast, blockchain allows Tclk to store data across nodes within the network, making it significantly more difficult to alter or delete historical data. Second is less transparency. A database is controlled by the administrator. Therefore, users often do not have access to view the history of the database or details around any alterations made to the data. In contrast, Tclk users can view the full submission history, increasing the trust across the user base. Another difference is the validation process. In other applications, the database administrator is in charge of validating all submissions. While users can flag erroneous data, they do not have any authority over correcting false information. Comparatively, Tclk crowdsources the validation efforts, meaning that users have transparency into the validation process by being able to validate submissions themselves. This approach also allows an extra layer of protection for data integrity, as Tclk has set a minimum validation threshold before a post can be shown on the application. A submission typically passes through 3 to 10 sets of eyes before being approved. Another difference between Tclk and other competing applications is the incentive structure. The last key difference of Tclk is the ability to provide tokens for users willing to volunteer their time. Because Tclk was built on Jingtum's blockchain platform, it could leverage Jingtum's own cryptocurrency as a reward for volunteers. The tokens could then be used at other vendors on the Jingtum platform to redeem small gifts. In other applications that were not built on blockchain, this same functionality would be possible only with fiat currency, which would be costlier and much more complex to administer. There are three weaknesses of existing solutions. First is transparency. And Tclk's data storage addresses this by providing a distributed ledger allowing all users to view submitted posts. Tclk's data storage uses blockchain, which is immutable, providing confidence that data cannot be tampered with by an administrator. Another weakness is reliability, which Tclk addresses in its validation process and data storage. Tclk facilitates multiple users, 3 to 10 validating submissions, to maintain data integrity. The third weakness is scalability. This is addressed in the validation process and incentive structure within the Tclk application. In Tclk, content is managed by volunteers, meaning minimal additional resources are required from the application to scale up. Further, volunteers are rewarded with digital tokens, incentivizing users to continue supporting the platform. So what should Moz's next step be? The case lays out 3 different paths for advancing the idea behind Tclk: geographic expansion, diversifying within the healthcare industry, and applying the blockchain concept in other industries. The success of introducing the application outside of China would depend on 4 geographic factors. First is progression of COVID-19 worldwide. Depending on other countries' level of success with containing the virus, it might already be too late to expand Tclk overseas. As the number of new cases begins to decrease and social distancing rules are relaxed, citizens become less concerned over new cases and therefore are less open to adopting a new platform such as Tclk. Also, cross-platform integration will influence the success of the application. Tclk was built for the Chinese WeChat platform and therefore, in its existing state, would not scale well outside of China. To expand to other regions, the platform integration would also require further development so that it would work with more globally used applications such as Facebook and WhatsApp. Third, Tclk will depend on its ability to be marketed. The application was built for a Chinese user base and therefore might not fit the profile of a user base in a different country. This discussion raises privacy concerns, as users in a different country may be uncomfortable submitting posts about infected individuals for fear of infringing on their privacy rights. To succeed in expansion into another country, Tclk would need to ensure that citizens of the other countries are comfortable with sharing and viewing this type of information. And finally, Tclk will depend on its ability to provide access to information. Many countries do not publish the same level of detailed information on COVID-19 cases as the Chinese government. This discrepancy is typically due to a mix of less sophisticated tracking and reporting mechanisms, along with different perspectives on privacy concerns. Therefore, any geographic expansion requires consideration of the data availability within the expanded regions. If successful, geographic expansion provides Tclk an opportunity to reach a broader range of audiences, which could then be leveraged when expanding the service offerings of the application. Another path for advancing the idea behind Tclk is diversifying within the healthcare industry. This can be viewed as expansion of Tclk across the healthcare value chain or internal operations within the healthcare supply chain. Because Tclk's user base is made up of citizens who have potentially been exposed to a virus, the application could be used to connect patients with hospitals or testing centers. Tclk would thus act as a sales funnel for these healthcare facilities, which could then be monetized by charging a commission for each patient referral made through the application. The key consideration for this strategy would be Tclk's ability to expand across other contagious diseases. To build a sustainable business-to-business model, Tclk would need to continue providing value after the COVID-19 crisis, which would likely involve expanding the tool to track other contagious diseases so that the blockchain acts as a crowdsourced database of all publicly reported contagious diseases. This model would also require a shift in strategy in terms of how to incentivize users to submit and validate cases without the pressure of a global pandemic motivating their support. Another path for Tclk is to apply the blockchain concept in other industries. The main concept of Tclk, which is using blockchain to crowdsource and validate important information, could be applied to problems outside of healthcare. Can you identify and explain how the concept could be relevant within different industries to address different business problems? While Tclk could expand in a multitude of ways, the goal is for you to acknowledge the benefits of blockchain for knowledge creation, information sharing, and information validation. Here are 4 examples of other applications of Tclk. First is tracking crime. Tclk could be leveraged to track publicly reported cases of crime by location and time. This information would be useful for citizens when making decisions such as purchasing a home, and organizations such as insurance companies could also use the information to inform their premiums for insurance. Because crime remains an important issue in society, Tclk could maintain a large user base along with a high number of volunteers willing to submit and validate publicly reported crimes. Another example is journalism. Tclk's platform could be used by news agencies and consumers to flag fake news. One of the greatest barriers in differentiating between real and fake news is the ability to track the data source cited by journalists and writers. With blockchain, the sources of articles from journalists to editors could be tracked in an immutable ledger, providing more transparency for readers. Furthermore, Tclk's crowdsourcing model could be used to validate online articles for false information. Each article could be distributed to multiple volunteers along with the sources of the articles. And when multiple volunteers identified an article as containing false information, that article could be flagged as a warning for users of the platform. Bargain hunting. Another popular source of information for internet users is bargain hunting sites such as GasBuddy.com and RedFlagDeals.com, where users post promotions and discounted pricing on forums for others' benefit. Tclk could fit into this business model by adding a layer allowing other users to validate and score each post and create a ranking system based on the validity and rarity of each bargain. Incorporating blockchain into bargain hunting would also introduce a greater incentive for volunteers compared with other websites, whereby volunteer posters and validators, in recognition of their contributions, could receive tokens that could then be used at partnering retailers. And finally, Tclk could be used to review and appraise businesses. Many existing websites and applications such as Yelp, Google, and TripAdvisor can be used for reviewing and recommending businesses to consumers. However, many of these services have been embroiled in controversies for their lack of transparency in ranking algorithms and the untraceable disappearance of reviews. For example, Yelp has been accused of extorting small businesses by removing positive reviews if these businesses did not pay for a premium account. Through blockchain, Tclk would be able to provide significantly greater transparency into the business review industry, as all reviews would be recorded in an immutable ledger. Details of the reviewer, for example, city of residence, number of other reviews, and check-in at the business in question could also be included on the blockchain to provide a level of trust within the user base, ensuring that bots or click farms cannot be used to skew the sorting algorithm. So what happened? By July 23, 2020, Tclk had been queried 42,623 times, and 15,319 submissions had been contributed by 387 people who had registered to support Tclk with data submissions. The submissions of 106 users who participated in the validation process were cumulatively validated 61,977 times. Of the 15,183 submissions that were reviewed, 15,072 passed the review process, over 99%. A total of 3,346,119 digital tokens were awarded, worth approximately 3,279 won, which is equivalent to $468. The highest compensated volunteer received 655,291 digital tokens, worth approximately 642 won, or $92. That's the end of the case. Thanks for watching.